A very warm welcome to you, Shaleen, on the call.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
And to introduce Shaleen, you're an officer on duty, special duty, with working with the health minister, Mr. Satinder Jain. Let's start the conversation by you sharing your journey with us so far with AAP. How long has it been since you've been associated with AAP, and how did it all begin?
So thank you, everyone, for having me this evening. And it was always a delight to have you all. And this is my third call with AAPka Radio. First call I had was in 2017, I guess, and then later in 2018. So it all started in 2010, like I've mentioned earlier also. So 2010, when PWG scam happened, it was Commonwealth Games scam. Everyone was shocked. So in 2010, everyone was so raged after CWG scam happened. Media was covering it all, and everyone was shocked looking at the numbers. That's when everyone joined hands together. Arvind Kejriwal was already, was leading the entire protest, and everyone decided to basically register an FIR. There was no FIR registered. So Ms. Kiran Bedi, Arvind Kejriwal, Manish Sisodia ji, Prashant Bhushan ji, Baba Ramdev, and other big names of Indian consciousness, they were all together to lead this mass to get this FIR registered. And we were all walking through the Parliament Street to get the FIR registered. We submitted a letter to the SHO that, look, we want to register this FIR. Obviously, registering an FIR by a crowd is not possible in the Indian system, and obviously the Congress government was there then, and we didn't get, actually, the success wasn't, you see, so we came back, but then movement got started. It was back in 2010, November, 14 November, if I recall it rightly. Since then, everyone got together, and then later this thought came out that CWG scam is not the only threat which the country is facing right now. It is about the corruption. And then came the first draft of the Lokpal bill. And then Anna ji was also brought in the picture. Arvind ji and everyone was looking for a face who could lead the movement. There was enough rage inside the country. Everyone was willing to, we all know what has happened, so I need not to narrate the entire story. And then that was my first, that was the first incident when I met a leader and I joined a public protest of this sort. It was
and
a
you
PR
were pleased,
event.
And I think you were, but, I think you were only 23 then, that's what you told me.
Yes. There was a team of not more than 23, 24 people who joined the entire thing then. And then later when Annaji came into the picture and the first draft came, Prashant Bhushanji bought this draft, and there was this committee formed to bring the entire draft in the public domain. Everyone was very much overwhelmed looking at the draft and the kind of response public was showing around the entire Lokpal movement. And then came 5th of April when Anna sat on fast. Media gave it a thumbs up. Everyone was, the country got a hope that something can be changed if Lokpal bill comes into the picture. And then starting from that month, April 5th, and then August 16th in the same year, to the formation of the committee which the government has agreed to. There were five members of the public representative. Arvind ji was part of it, Manish ji was part of it, Kiran ji was part of it, and Prashant Bhushan ji was part
of it. Unfortunately, we still are not seeing any light in that. So that's the thing. But Shaleen, let me short here a little and tell us a little. You know, a lot of youth that time had given up their careers and their job, even their studies to be part of this movement. And some of them have been rewarded, like you. You know, you are doing good. But there are many who are disillusioned by the whole process. What would you say to that?
See it. So the country, I mean, the current scenario is very much different. We have BJP in power right now. Aam Aadmi Party came into the picture with a movement called Lokpal movement, and then there was this hope that something can be changed. And in the leadership of Arvind ji, everyone, there was a big segment of people who were not accepting the entire idea of coming into politics. They were saying that when you can be a big movement like this, you need not to join active politics. You will become like other parties. And there was a big chunk of the people who were skeptical of joining this entire idea. But I was one of them. I completely rejected the idea. We had a good and big argument with Manish ji, and then Arvind ji, and then Swati was my colleague. So we fought the entire night when the decision was taken, and sooner or later we realized that okay, these are good people, let us stay with them, let us see what they can do, let us see how things work. And eventually things turned out to be different. I mean, I was working with, in 2013 election, I was working with Dinesh Mohania, who was my good friend and who is still a good friend. And 2015, I worked for Chhatarpur Vidhan Sabha. So in both the elections, we fought with parties who were like big chunk at that time. I mean, no one was hoping that the Congress will come to this stage, at least in Delhi. In 2015, they received zero. In 2020, they received zero. So no one was hoping that Aam Aadmi Party will emerge like this.
Right.
And not just in Delhi, in other parts of the country too. So,
yeah.
However, we couldn't form government in other parts of the country. But then there is this hope that something can be achieved. For those who were not willing to join active politics, or those who were not getting this idea of becoming a political party, there is a chunk of people who still say that you are doing good, but we don't see ourselves joining Aam Aadmi Party even now, because they don't think that political parties can bring solution to the country. So there is a complete perception difference between one's perception and other's perception. So it is a pile of perception right now. But what I see, what Aam Aadmi Party has done so far, in the specifically in the area of education and health, this has been a remarkable journey. And as far as rewarding is concerned, I don't think we have been rewarded like such, because we were all working in different segments of the country of our work. I was working in apparel segment before. After the Andolan, I left my job in 2011 after the beginning of the Andolan in May, second week I left my company, and then for another 7 months I worked full time with the Andolan without getting even a single rupee. It was my completely, my call, and I lived to it. Even while the elections were, when the party was formed in 2013, 2015, we all gave our sacrifices like we could do, and that was for our own wish.
Yeah.
That was to satisfy our own consciousness. It was not to impress someone or to get rewarded at all. Later,
right.
when party got into power, and when we decided that we need to have a team of volunteers who are there to help ministers in day-to-day functioning, everyone was, I was called to join the then Women and Child Minister by Swati and by Manish ji, that look, you can work with them, because I was very much interested into working for the children, and primarily in the area of substance abuse and drug addiction. So
right.
I was called and I was delighted to join them. We didn't get salary for good 7 months in the initial appointment, and this is my fifth appointment. For good 19 to 20 months, I wasn't paid. I worked there as a volunteer.
Okay.
Because services is a department which Delhi government is not, doesn't control
right.
even right now. There's a
right,
case
right.
going on in the Supreme Court, and Supreme Court has to decide. So it was all our conscious call that, look, we need to now change things. We were there at the other side of the table. Now, when we are brought into power, we have to decide for things. We have to change things which we can do at our end. We can't just say that, look, mera to family hai, mera to ghar hai, so I am not going to make those sacrifices. And we have been paid at least, around some of us are getting 70% of what they were getting earlier. I'm getting 60% of the salary I was getting earlier. So, and there is no, there is no reward as such. We reach out to the office at our own convenience. And the important part of this journey was that we showed the picture of how good governance can be achieved.
Right.
And it becomes our role and responsibility to now change things when we are in power.
Right. It's been a terrific, model that we have shown the world. You know, even volunteers, terrific sacrifice from the volunteers. Some of them who are not even married. We'll come back to that. But Charlene, tell us, after the Delhi riot, after our elections, after we won, we barely had any time to enjoy, and so many controversies followed, including the riots and everything after that. And after a long time, we now have some good news again coming from Delhi, and everybody is appreciating the way we defeated Corona. What has your experience been with this?
Well, being a part of the health department at least, and it was not after the election, even before we went for the election, and there was this month, in starting November 2019, we've been struggling first to bring peace in the city, because starting CAA movement, the first thing which hit was Jamia protest. There is a university called Jamia Millia Islamia in Delhi.
Right.
There was this protest happened. Police got entered into the premises without permission from the VC. And you would have, if those who are interested in Indian politics and those who have been reading what was happening, starting the Jamia protest and then the JNU and then the Delhi riots. And from now, after the riots, which went for some 18 days, the corona period started.
Okay.
And now when we are sitting in the month of July, we can happily say that even when we are testing around 20,000 samples every day, the positivity rate is very low. It's coming around 5.5 to 6% each day, which has earlier reached out to a 21 to 23%. So when we were testing some 10,000 to 12,000 patients every day, now we are testing 20,000 each day, and the positive percentage is still coming down. And now when I'm speaking to you, there's this zero surveillance going on in the city. It'll end by 7th of August, when we will say how many of the Delhi citizens have been detected with COVID positivity and whether or not they have develop antibodies, which is a indication that they have been an asymptomatic carrier in the past, and that's how they have got antibodies now. So there was a big struggle to get things arranged, but as Delhi had good infrastructure in place, as we had Mohalla Clinics, 450 Mohalla Clinics operate under operation at that moment of time, 162 dispensaries, 40 polyclinics, 37 hospitals with around 200-250 beds each, and we could still tackle the situation. But then as the need emerged, BJP is telling us that, look, you were expecting 5.5 lakhs cases by the end of July 31st, and we are at a very good number right now. That's that is because of the intervention of the central government. So now they are fighting for the credit. But then 5.5, how did we get this number? So 5.5 lakh was an expected number if this, following the speed at which the corona was growing it. So we were anticipating this number and we were preparing for the worst. That's what was expected to turn out to be. But we were too be prepared for the worst. And that's how we were scaling up on our number of beds. We were scaling on the number of ambulances we had. There were 132 ambulances in the city. Currently, we are having 600 ambulances functional right now. So there was this big change which happened. So Ola and Uber offered us that, look, we have, at the time of lockdown, we have good 500 cabs standing in our parking stations. You can use it for transportation of your staff members. But then we took a call that, look, staff can still manage for their transportation. Or we have got enough, we got them buses. For each of the hospital, we issued Delhi Transport Corporation buses that, look, you can pool them from a specific point to the hospital. But then what we are going to use these Uber and Ola cabs is to transport patients, which no one had ever thought for. So we use these mini cabs to bring asymptomatic patients to the clinics, to the hospitals. And this has been a very good decision so far.
Right.
And other states have also emulated this. So there were many decisions like these, which turned out to be a savior in the long run. And that's how we have now reached out to a point when everything seems to be under control.
Okay, that's great. Do we have any questions?
Hi, Charlene. This is Prashant here, volunteer from Zurich. Thanks a lot for joining with us. So my question is a very common criticism, which is also being pointed out by the blogs like Wire and Scrawl and others. It is that the positivity rate in Delhi is artificially coming down because of using antigen tests more and more. Antigen tests are apparently supposed to be much less reliable than RT-PCR testing. And since 3/4 of our tests are happening through antigens, we are apparently showcasing a false picture. How exactly do we counter this narrative?
Right. So, starting 25th of this month, July, I have looked at the total number of patients which are coming out to be positive against the number of tests we are doing on RT-PCR and likewise on the antigen testing. So around 3 to 3.5% of people coming out to be positive was tested on antigen. However, around 7 to 8% of people who were tested positive was actually tested on RT-PCR. So, and the weighted aggregate comes out to be around 5.5% right now. So I'm speaking about the last week of July.
Yeah.
There are two significant reasons of why the percentage is coming up in the case of RT-PCR. One, we are referring for each symptomatic patient. We are referring them to RT-PCR right away. We are not telling them to first test for antigen and then to call on RT-PCR. We are right away forwarding them to be tested on RT-PCR. Mm-hmm. And for those cases who are symptomatic and willing to get their report in an hour or so and want to get themselves tested at an antigen lab, they are first tested on antigen. And if the report is not coming out to be positive, we are sending them their samples on RT-PCR also. Mm-hmm. So in one way, these antigen testings are only for those patients who are willing to get them tested by themselves. Mm-hmm. They're not telling the symptomatic patients to get themselves tested on antigen by ourselves. So even, the number of tests which has increased, so our problem is that RT-PCR lab are very much, we have a good 6,000 to 7,000 capacity of testing RT-PCR each day. Mm-hmm. However, antigen can be increased to a big extent. There is no limitation because it doesn't need an RT-PCR machine per se. So, looking at this limitation, only those cases who are not symptomatic have been referred on antigen. It doesn't mean that we intentionally brought down this number by ourselves. There was this limitation, and obviously, symptomatic cases are still, and had been had there been a situation like the number of people who are positive and have been left out because we are not testing them on RT-PCR. There is no case. That is the only apprehension which we have, and that's the basic idea why we share this apprehension. So they have already been referred on RT-PCR. Had there been a case like this, RT-PCR positivity ratio should have been much higher. But it is still under 7 to 8%. However, those are symptomatic. Most of them are symptomatic patients, or maybe a patient whom those who need surgery and those who have to undergo a surgery, and doctors are asking for RT-PCR before they actually get admitted into a hospital. Only in case of like I was traveling a week ago, I had to get myself tested for my own satisfaction. So then doctor asked, is there a symptom? And I said, no, I don't have any symptom, neither do I have any contact with a positive case, but I want to get myself tested just for the sake of my satisfaction. They said that better to go on antigen. If you are willing to go on RT-PCR also, then you are open to go, but then the result is going to come in another 2 or 3 days. I said, I would travel. So they said, okay, antigen testing, while you're not exhibiting any symptom, then you can probably get yourself tested on antigen. But if you want, RT-PCR is also available. So there is no limitation from the side of the government is what I want to say. Yeah.
Right.
Okay, Shaleen, since you're here, let's take this opportunity to understand a bit about how are you testing? You know, are you going door-to-door testing, or people are coming to you for testing? How is it happening? And then what happens that if you test positive?
Yeah, so that is a very important question. So we have got 193 testing centers for antigen. All our hospitals, all our polyclinics are testing RT-PCR from the very beginning.
Okay.
Plus, there are private labs who have been authorized. There are more than 40 labs in Delhi who have been testing for RT-PCR since April 20. So,
okay.
193 centers are good enough. There are these schools also. There are the dispensary buildings also where antigen testing is available. Even in our office, antigen testing and RT-PCR testing, both are available. So one can refer. For RT-PCR, you need a prescription. Doctor has to say that you are exhibiting a symptom and you need RT-PCR test. Or maybe if you are traveling, I mean, you have to present a case that why you need RT-PCR testing.
Okay.
Or if you can console, convince your doctor that you need an RT-PCR test, and if doctor refers, then you can get yourself tested on RT-PCR also. So there are good 300 plus centers in Delhi where this testing is going on.
Okay. So, and what happens after you test positive? You know, what is the process? Immediately?
Right. So that is a very crucial thing. Immediately when you are tested positive, we have hired a call center, which is called Step 1. So this form is called Step 1. If suppose I have been tested positive, my phone number will, so while they take your sample, they take your phone number and your credentials, like your address, etc. And then immediately you'll receive a call that your sample has been tested positive. I'll receive from a call from the district surveillance officer or the staff that look, what's your address? And you have been tested positive. Are you exhibiting any symptom? They'll come to my residence. They'll check my oxygen saturation level, they'll check my temperature, and they'll prepare a case sheet. If there is a need to shift me to a nearby hospital, they'll take a call. Right? If me and the health worker will feel that I have this space in my house that I can stay alone, I can take care of my utensils and clothes, I can isolate myself easily, then I'll be given an opportunity to stay in a home isolation space. I'll be given a oxygen oximeter. Delhi government has distributed good 60,000 oximeters since the beginning of COVID period. And this will help me understand whether or not my oxygen saturation level is going down. If my oxygen saturation level goes down, it comes out to be less than 95, then I can I have been told to call on a particular number to get an ambulance, and ambulance will reach out to me in 20 minutes and I'll be shifted to a hospital. So this is a way how you can self-monitor your symptoms, and when there is a need to shift, you can immediately be shifted to a hospital. And then obviously there are good number of beds which are lying unoccupied.
Okay. Do we have any questions?
Thank you very much for your dedication and for your volunteer work. I think that's a real definition of volunteer, which is you're lacking some of my NRI colleagues, you know, they are saying. But as far as the COVID issue, I know there is some propaganda going on, but my questions are, there are two different tests. And the antigen test, what is the, it does give a drawback, is it's give us more false positive or it give us a more false negative?
I think Shaleen already answered that, Dr. Grewal, but would you like to add?
No. What I'm saying is it's like what I'm trying to do is sometime, you know, what they do is that they do the antigen test for everybody because that cost is way low on that test and that's easy to do. And then the
right.
people who are positive, then they go to a next screen, the next test, which is a confirmatory test. And how much
Shaleen
is the
already
cost?
Shaleen explained the process that why they offer this test and why not the other test. So,
yeah.
you know.
But my question is how much is the cost? Different? You have an idea what is the
right.
the cost
so,
is for the
right.
antigen and other test?
Yeah.
Right. So, antigen costs us around 450 rupees per test. For RT-PCR, okay. I mean, in a private lab, you will be, I mean, we have shifted. From 4,000 to 2,400, and it to government it costs around 1,800 rupees per test.
Okay. That's the, because reason why I'm saying it because in Punjab, you know that what the government is charging, that's way higher than what they.
Well, the government,
you
know, Punjab.
In Delhi, we are doing for free.
Yeah, Punjab government is also charging for the blood, which people are donating for free, and
Now they did a U-turn for after agitation from the resistance from the Aam Aadmi Party. That's a good thing, but that gives them a really like it for one month, give them big shit, you know.
Yeah.
Their blood sucker, you know.
So Shaleen, tell us how successful has our plasma bank been? There are a lot of states, you know, a lot of terrified people saying that, our father is sick or mother is sick and we need plasma urgently. But I'm not seeing that from Delhi. Other states are constantly advertising on social media. You see everywhere people are like wanting blood. But how's it in Delhi?
So there was a situation like other states are facing right now. In Delhi also, until we launched ILBS and LNJP labs. And there was this reason to it. I mean, suddenly there was this requirement of plasma got increased manifold. And we were skeptical why this requirement has increased. And we sense that there is this mafia of plasma also coming into the picture. I mean, ask you that you need to donate plasma, and then you will agree to donate. Your plasma will be kept and will be sold to other states and will be sold to other hospitals, because you never know whether your patient has been actually given plasma or not. That was it. And plus, there were fake donors also coming to the picture, that they would agree to you that I'm ready to come. Donate plasma, they will ask some money, you will pay them some money, and then they will just switch off their phone and go away. There are many such cases which have been highlighted. Plus, there were cases where obviously there was this requirement of plasma, and then everyone would wait for, mostly in cases of those blood groups which are not found easily. So they would rate your plasma and you will sell it. So this mafia was coming to the picture. So we decided that why can't we do it by ourselves, and we set up a plasma lab. It took us good 40-45 days to get approval from the central government. But then once this instead of leaving biology sciences, got this plasma first Indian, first plasma bank in India. Everything was seems to be on the right path, and it started sorting out for us. Hello. Later, now in the month of July, we have started with LNJP also. So there are two labs in the city working right now, and we have given plasma to more than 650 patients in the period of 4 months now.
What percentage of COVID? What percentage of COVID recovered patients are donating plasma at this time? Do we have some statistics around that? This is Pankaj, by the way.
Very meager. I mean, we have been aggressively campaigning for this entire idea. Few of our radio partners, NDTV. Now everyone has started the campaign to for the patients to understand that they are not going to get themselves harmed. If they donate plasma, they will still get antibodies developed. There were apprehensions coming out that what if our one of our family members got infected and they would need plasma, nobody will come out. We are saving plasma for them. So there were many apprehensions and many conservative ideas coming out. Now what we are doing is that the step one, the company which we have hired as a call center, those who have been recovered will be called by our call center to basically convince them to donate plasma. But unfortunately, the percentage is not good. I wouldn't ask for the data, but then to my understanding, it is not beyond 8% of the recovered patients. And in some cases also, you don't get enough antibodies developed so that you can ask for plasma. And for pregnant ladies, so you don't actually ask them for plasma. So there is this, 90% of the cases can donate, but then less than 10% are donating right now.
Really, but the exercise extensively for this, even then it's not helping? Yeah, Pankaj, sorry, I just cut you. You were asking
okay, yeah, I was just going to say, is there a possibility to set up a home delivery sort of a system by which somebody could go to someone's home? They may have a reluctance in going to a hospital, we can collect the plasma from home.
It's not possible because the infrastructure requires the patient to come to the lab and donate it. It's a process. It takes good 4 to 5 hours for the entire process. However, we have arranged cabs for them. We are taking them from their homes, and then after the donation, we pick up and drop facility is available. So that has been a important point that was required from in the first place. We are hoping that the number is going to increase now when the campaigns are starting and now people are understanding. Yesterday only one of our team member Amresh has shot a video of a donor who has donated plasma for 7th times. And we will be, you will be seeing that video on Aam Aadmi Party's Twitter page and Facebook page in a couple of days. So we are also promoting it to the extent we can. But then people have to understand that there is this need of you to come out and donate plasma.
So my question is regarding the oxygen meter. I also purchase oxygen meter, but I don't know what is the next step. If something happens and the oxygen level goes high, then what is the next step? I think you explained a little bit. If you can clarify a little more details on it, what to do after having the oxygen meter, that will help.
Oximeter, you are saying? It's a small instrument through which you can measure your oxygen level in your blood.
Yeah. I also purchased it from Amazon. Yeah.
Okay. So should the oximeter only signifies is your whether your oxygen saturation level is coming down. So it should ideally be 9900. Today I measured mine, so it was coming out to be 99. But in case it goes down below 95 for asthmatic patients, it usually, my mother is asthmatic, so I know that her saturation level goes around 95-96. But then if you get infected COVID, you will likely, in severe conditions, your saturation level will come down and it will reach to 92-94. So our call is that immediately you have to reach out to a hospital, get yourself admitted, and then they are going to give you oxygen. So now people have started using, like Mantriji is now using a cylinder in his own house. So whenever his saturation level goes down, he starts start using that oxygen cylinder. Oxygen concentrators are also coming in. What they do, they get oxygen concentrated through environment in our, I mean, from our environment only, and then you can use it. And you can always control your supply. You have to learn how much supply you need to give. And doctors are there in on our con call also. They can better explain. But then you need to basically they tell you that what at what level of saturation level, what kind of, I mean, what amount of oxygen you need to be given. That's it. From 5 okay. liter to 10 liter to 15 liter as per your requirement saturation level.
Okay. Yeah, Dr. Graver.
Thank you.
Yeah, Dr. Graver.
Yeah, my question is again, it's related to the COVID. Because of this number, we have a good number in New Delhi and even in India, some part of it, India. Are we doing any antibody testing to see the how much population of the area is some are not symptomatic, and then they can still have antibodies, and that number, as the number go up, that's going to be there for the KJ. And how much it cost if we are doing the antibody test for the common?
So for each antibody test, it costs us around so the size of the vial and costs us around 250 for each test. If you go in private hospital, they will charge you 800 rupees. Our costing is coming out to be around 330-340 rupees per test. And as I've said already, during the serosurveillance, so we are reaching out to the community. We have taken a sample of 15,000 people from whom we are going to get these samples, and we're going to test whether they have developed antibodies or not. And that surveillance is right now going on. That survey is right now going on.
Oh,
starting 1st of August, it'll go till 7th. And the result is likely to come before 12th or before 13th. So NCDC, National Center for Disease Control, has established a method which we have adopted from the permission of the Government of India. And now this survey will tell us how many of us have already got infected and how much of the percentage has got antibodies in themselves. During last survey, which has happened in the first week of July, it has come to the fore that around 25% of Delhiites have actually got infected from COVID, and they have got antibodies in them. It is a very big number. But then there are different concepts of herd immunity, which says that from 60-70% patients have to get antibodies in them for the virus to become harmless. So
yeah, is going
to come up.
Yeah, the follow-up question
to come up by 12th of August. Yes, please continue. Yeah.
The follow-up question is: it's a very inexpensive test, and it's how long it takes. Because the reason why I'm asking is because if you do an antibody test, and some of the population, let's say 20-25%, 30% of the population, they will be more do their own businesses, some of the special businesses, sometimes the essential services. And that is very important to let the people that they can do work fearlessly if they have the antibodies, and if they are already positive and they recover first time without any harm. So if we do that on a large number, let's say we do a large number, we have a 30% of the population, those 30% population will have less restrictions because they are not on any risk to have a COVID-19. So that was my, because it's very inexpensive, that should be done on a large level.
Okay.
And there are different theories, Dr. Saab. I mean, I was discussing this with the senior pulmonologist of the Max Hospital. He was saying that there are good number of cases which says that they're not susceptible towards getting themselves infected again when they have developed antibodies. But then there are cases who have got infected again. And ICMR hasn't said this. So until ICMR approves this idea, we can't really go by it. A. B. We are telling each of the person who get tested that, look, you have got antibodies in you, and we also note down whether they have exhibited any symptoms in the past or not. And then they've also been told about what precautions you need to take and whether you can donate plasma or not. So, but then until ICMR approves anything, we can't really go by this idea. So that's our apprehension.
That's basically the idea of herd immunity, basically, in any disease. Yeah. Is like once you got the exposure of the same virus, if you survive one time, the chances of survival second time are much higher, because at the time when you got exposed, you do not have any immunity. So now you have, you are armed with something which you can fight. So the idea is just to do the, if it's a cost effective, very less cost and time, it will give a confidence that how much number. I think you are always doing it, what we are supposed to. And even especially in the area which is a hotspot, you know, that you can do more testing in that area to the out of, okay, how many people, if we have a 40% of the herd is perhaps showing the antigen, and then you are not on that risk. And that's what I think.
Yeah.
Right.
This is Akhil.
Yes. Akhil from California.
Yeah.
So, are we monitoring?
Hi, Akhil.
So, are we monitoring medical facilities for non-COVID patients like kidney dialysis, chemotherapy?
Very important question. So, in the first month of the COVID period, we and our team we also have a helpline called 1031, to which I and my team monitors the cases which are coming out. So every citizen can, those who are going, reaching out to their respective hospitals, can register a complaint by dialing 1031. And there is this team of nodal officers in each of our hospitals, those who have to respond to each of the grievances registered and have to resolve it. So one of my team members has also joined this call, Kamakshi is there on the line. She told me that, look, many of the patients, those who are facing challenges, have not been addressed. So cases like chemotherapy, radiotherapy, pregnant women, they are not being seen, and they have been running from pillar to post for them to get admitted, and no hospital is paying heed to them. And in those cases, in a couple of cases, we have issued show cause notice also. And then this idea came up that we came with this idea that whosoever with chemotherapy requirement or a pregnant woman, or there is a list of 7 to 9 tests which I'm not able to recall completely, but then we made a scheme that any patient can reach out to any private or government hospital. Even private hospitals are covered. Government is going to pay for their charges during this entire COVID period for these specific procedures. So suppose there is this pregnant woman who has to get her ANC done and her admission is required, then she can go get herself admitted in a private hospital, need not to pay, government is going to pay them from our pocket. Likewise for chemotherapy, likewise for radiotherapy and then other procedures also. So obviously, while there are many cases reported in media also, in mainstream media, electronic and print both, many cases in AIMS, because once the government decides that these hospitals are no more taking regular patients, they have to be either transferred to other hospitals or have to just discharged from the hospital. So in many of the cases, like cancer patients, when we decided that GTB hospital is going to be a COVID hospital, we booked some 200 beds in Dharamshila Hospital, which is a cancer hospital, and all the patients got treatment there without paying a single penny.
Okay.
So this was a very important and crucial part of the entire. Many patients are still struggling, and I would take this opportunity to request you all, if any cases comes out in your notice, send details to me. We'll ensure that their treatment happens in any of our hospitals. So we have other hospitals also, like the Deen Dayal Upadhyaya Hospital is there, where almost each and every department is there, except neurology and neurosurgery. These patients can be treated there. For neurology and neurosurgery, GB Pant Hospital is available. And these are all free of cost hospitals which are there in this time. However, Government of India has still not agreed to arrange permission for the state government to go ahead with the elective surgery part. So there are many cases lying unattended. Like if you could get your knee replacement done, if there is any elective sort of surgery which you need to undergo. The government has not permitted hospitals and the state governments to go and treat those patients. And there are many cases lying unattended. But then this scheme, which was the only, the Delhi government was the only government who decided for these patients. Otherwise, these patients were running still unenforced. And still, I find patients struggling to get treatment. They are not COVID positive, but they are not admitted in hospitals like they used to get treatment earlier.
Okay, Shalin, there is one question come in. If somebody wants to get themselves tested, is the antibody test that they have to do called COVID antibody test or CLIA?
Yeah, you can. Not many labs are doing it right now, but then this test is very easily available. So these are popularly known as antibody tests only. And you can get yourself tested. Recently, I've got Sanjay Singh tested. So I have to just call a lab, ensure that they are running this test, and they will be useful enough to ensure that the result is going to come out in 12 hours. It takes not more than 12 hours.
Okay, Shalin, tell us, like, how has things on the ground changed, you know, the perception so far? Are we getting a lot of accolades? The media is doing a good coverage of how Delhi has conquered the corona crisis. But what about people on the ground? Are you getting any feedback from the ground?
Right. So, certainly, yes. Until last month, until June 15th, we were in Berry. A bad situation. There were many challenges. Media was completely ruthless. Even for our good attempts, they were not presenting it. But then things changed as the number coming down. People have started accepting the entire idea of how Delhi model has been a successful model. Our distribution of oximeters are using caps as ambulances, our home isolation procedure, our call center services, visit by our healthcare staff. Everything has turned out to be a savior. So now other states are adopting the entire thing. And after PM Modi said this in a tweet or maybe in a media bite that yes, Delhi model has so far turned out to be successful. And each and every state should adopt the entire thing. And now people are accepting the entire edge. Otherwise, I'll tell you, in UP, in western part of UP, I've seen that if you get COVID positive, you're not going to, if you are even facing symptoms, you're not going to go in a hospital and get yourself treated, because you know that if this been a COVID infection, then the police will come with an ambulance, with a team of 5-7 staff, and they're going to take you to a government hospital, and then the kind of treatment you're going to get, you know, what system and what infrastructure is there in UP at least. So nobody is going to get themselves tested in the first place. And then if the report is going to come out, then they will even run away, and they'll just go to their acquaintances' house, or they'll change their city. This is the situation, and this is what's going on even right now. But as we accepted the entire idea of home isolation, because 90% of the patients do not need any hospitalization, people have now started understanding that, look, we need to live with this disease. Only what the crucial part is that we need to save our senior citizens. And if we are in a situation that there are acute symptoms, there are severe symptoms, then we need to understand where the treatment is available, and I have to arrange money for myself. If you are in a state like UP, then you are your own savior. Nobody is going to save you. So people have at least understand. Government has also understand that, look, we need not to have everyone hospitalized. That was the basic understanding of it. And there are many strains as far as COVID-19, and what my understanding has been, that not every patient actually needs hospitalization, and not every strain is fatal. So with this acceptance, Delhi model has now been very popular. Every now and then we have been listening that one or the other state has accepted the entire idea of how the Delhi government has controlled COVID.
My question is, I know that Delhi, we are able to control, and we are, every situation is the hospitalizations go down and the beds are available, everything is. How we are dealing with the, first of all, how we are dealing with the people, because if they have a bad treatment in UP, they should come, they will try to come to the Delhi and also start in manufacturing. And second part of the question is, if you can address that one, is I was looking on all data from different countries and stuff, the death rate for positive, per positive case is very low in all the Asian countries. I was looking the numbers from even Pakistan, Bangladesh, India, all those, countries, I would say the Western countries. And is there any kind of genetic or something? Did you find anything in the search like that? Is there any kind of information for that, please?
So, Doctor, first part of your question. I got the first part of the question, which was, if neighbor cities require facilities of Delhi, obviously Delhi has been our capital state, and we have been openly and overwhelmingly welcomed our neighbor cities. But then the idea is that why can't each of our states adopt Delhi governance model as a whole? Why can't our cities, I've been living in Delhi for the last 13-14 years. So there are cities like Noida, one of the highest revenue generating city of UP. There is this Gurgaon, Faridabad. Gurgaon is now Gurugram. So Gurugram, Faridabad, and Bahadurgarh. These three cities belongs to Haryana. All these three cities are having IT companies, all big fours are there. They've been revenue generating for Haryana government also. But then none of these cities has even a single hospital which can be compared to any of our hospitals, any of the Delhi government hospitals. And it's not about the Delhi, we have not developed each of these hospitals. This has been there for last many years. Congress has also developed many of this infrastructure. Now we have inaugurated one 450-bed hospital in Burari. Another hospital is going to come up in next week. We are going to launch it. So we can say that in the last 5 years, there is a significant progress in these five hospitals which we are going to start in a couple of years. From 10,000 beds to now we have reached 15,000 beds, and in a few years we'll reach 2,000 beds also. Then what have these cities done? They haven't invested on healthcare. Leave Delhi. Take example of Mumbai. Mumbai has been investing in healthcare. Why can't UP do it? Why can't Haryana do it? Haryana is a very small state. with a population of 3 crores, less than 3 crores. They can do it very easily. And I mean, their densities are not, they're not as dense as Delhi. So Delhi has got 2 crore voters, around 3 crore residents. So it comes out to very much closer to the Haryana as a complete state. Why can't they afford to invest in healthcare or in education? So now country has to understand, and now we also need to promote.
Shalini, the joke today is that Amit Shah tested positive. Even to take care of himself, there is no hospital built by him, you know, in 6 years. So they, even they have to rely on a hospital built in the previous regime. So it's such a shameful thing. At least they'll be, they should be ashamed of these things now.
Mm-hmm. And they are not getting themselves admitted in even AIMS. So they don't even trust AIMS facility. And this is also shameful in many different regards. They are admitting into a priceless hospital without exhibiting a symptom. So there's this fear of government infrastructure in the first place.
Okay. Okay. Shalini, thanks a lot for this very, very informative session. I just would like to know, how are people, you know, every time we generate a lot of goodwill, we also lose it pretty quickly because of negative campaigning. As a long-time volunteer and as somebody who has been with the party from the right from the beginning, what do you think is a solution for this, and what are you all doing to combat this? Like somebody yesterday suggested that we should have a dedicated band of people just to, you know, every time there is a negativity that erupts, we should have a dedicated band of volunteers just dedicated to, you know, answering those questions. Like during the riots or when, you know, Jamia was attacked or when JNU was attacked, the silence, you know, we should have a dedicated band before it becomes a completely negative campaign. How do you see all this?
So there are two ways of how I look at it. One part is that, yeah, very much we have a good strength of volunteers available to us, unlike to any other party. Forget Congress, even BJP has all these hired trolls. Otherwise, no one can compare to what Aam Aadmi Party has volunteer strength. So we should definitely go on with this idea that we should be vigilant enough if someone is like criticizing our government without a logic behind it. We must answer. But then Indian media has turned out to be a very loose state. So except a few channels, you won't see any channel talking about the genuine concerns of the people. They will talk about 10 number of things, but about the entire. So they are not going to talk about the genuine concerns of the people. So
right.
We have also understood in this sea of sharks that if we are going to get into, if we have to stay in the politics, we need to understand how media functions, and we need to have a strategy to control it, to manage it. And we have been doing it without spending a single amount of fee, single penny from our pocket. And this has been a very important feature of how Arvindji has been planning the entire campaigning of ours. Like, if you see, in the last year, we were all losing hopes that whether after Lok Sabha elections, whether or not we are going to come in the Delhi Vidhan Sabha elections again. But then things changed. How why? Because we reached out to each of these channels. We gave interview to whosoever was willing to. And then things turned out to be positive. Logo ko samajh aane laga ki now Delhi government has been working well with schemes like Farisht Delhi Ke, with schemes like the water work we have done in education. And so our promotion has been a very decent one. So media management is also a skill which we are learning on, and obviously our volunteers have always, they have been a very important part of our team. Their strength, their the way they counter false propaganda, the way they speak with their friends, acquaintances. This has been a core idea of how we have understood the entire idea of politics. And obviously we have to do both. We have to get these volunteers going, and we also need to manage how typically Indian media has been working, be it any channel. And you have changed, I mean, you would have seen this change. We are now giving interviews to Z News. I mean, Z News was one of our most critical channels.
Right.
We have not been speaking to them. Now we are giving interview to the Republic also, India News also, 24 also. Each and every channel we are speaking to, we are now under. We have now understood that if we are going to be in the game, we need to understand things, and the result is paying off.
Okay.
One question I have for as far as I know this COVID is a very bad thing happen, but in the end of the day, I think in India or in the world level, it will be a silver lining for daily model, because what we have done in that kind of area that will be exposed to other states, other people. My question is, are we doing to collect individual testimony from the people to directly get benefit or directly get saved by the, and they directly got quarantined and get a test of quality? And if you're collecting that material, there's small audio clips which we can use as a positive side of the, if they're doing negative propaganda, we can use that the experience for the people when they're saying from their own mouth, you know, that how good they were treated and how thankful they are to the, so we should collect that all and we can use in other states.
We're doing
like
it.
Punjab.
We're doing it. I've put one of our team members specifically to address this. So
we've
now been collecting testimonies from them at party level, from our health team. And if required, we're going to hire an agency also to get this work done. And we have enough number of testimonies which we're going to use at different times. And also because we can't go on a complete campaign mode right now. You never know whether COVID is going to come back or not. This is just a time. I mean, so even if we look at the current numbers, even for the last 4 days, the number is constantly, is constant in on around 1,000 to 1,100.
Yeah.
It's not coming down. It had come down 2-3 days before, but then for the last four or five days, I've seen that the number is constantly stable. So we can't really say that COVID period has gone and everything
has
been.
That's
so we need not to go into campaigning mode right now, but then we are collecting testimonies, and that's a very essential idea of it.
Making a good, like a bank of good things, and then later on, because next year we can use in Punjab for just like a personal small introduce from the people who get from benefit from to health and school or at a electric bill, all those things which can make a material for the next state, and that will be the Punjab. I think that will be a good idea that can go to every drawing room, you know, so that people can understand what my board will work.
Okay, Charlene, one last note before we end this call. Tell us, how do you balance your personal and professional life? I think, you know, all our app leaders and volunteers, everybody is overworked. And I would really like to know how you all balance your personal and professional life.
We have not been very much successful on this, in this regard. And let me honestly accept this. And it's about our family who has been sacrificing behind all these 12 years. There is a lot of struggle, and there is a lot of patience which has been under this struggle. So, and obviously, there are volunteers who have been our strength, who have been promoting the entire idea of how political parties should function, and how, I mean, obviously, so if you're going to enjoy all the whims and fancies and going to live that leisure, then you can't really give your bit. You can't really change things. So struggle has been there. We have also learned many things during the struggle, and hopefully things are going to come a little stable. And thanks to our family, who have been a very essential part of it.
So hats off to guys like you, and hats off to the families involved also for all the sacrifices made. Thanks a lot again, Charlene, for coming on our call, and thank you for answering all the questions so patiently. Good day, good night to you, and good day to the rest of us here.